Tonight we are in the mountains of Colombia's west coast, and we are looking for Xenesthis. This is a genus of fairly large and popular tarantulas in the New World, and we will not be looking for them in burrows, but rather they should be wandering around at night. Right down here we have our first Xenesthis tarantula, an adult female. It is possible that this tarantula is undescribed, but if it can be attributed to any known species, it's most likely going to be Xenesthis monstrosa. Xenesthis is not a very diverse genus. It only contains 5 described species, and if I recall correctly, none of them really have a common name. These are the largest tarantulas in Solano Bay, which is where I am right now, and probably the largest tarantulas in Colombia outside of the Amazon. While we are trying to find these tarantulas on the move tonight, they're usually sedentary and live in burrows, and these are burrows with no apparent silk lining the entrance. Unsurprisingly, the genus Xenesthis is quite well known for its color combination and its pattern, but I am here to tell you that, unfortunately, the one that we have here is relatively drab compared to most of the ones out here. In immatures and adult females, this coloration is limited to the prosoma and the femurs, but this is generally not true for adult males, which tend to be quite a bit more colorful. And don't get your hopes up, we're likely not going to see any tonight. Right down here in the leaves, we have a Pliocercus euryzonus, or the Halloween snake. This Halloween snake that we have here is one of 2 main morphs for this species. This one, as you can tell, is just black and white, but a lot of them have quite a bit of orange in their bands as well, and that's what gives them the name Halloween snake. These are found in Nicaragua, Costa Rica, Panama, Western Colombia, and Western Ecuador. They're both diurnal and nocturnal, and kind of the perfect example of a terrestrial snake. They don't have any arboreal tendencies, and don't really have fossorial habits either. You can see the tip of this one's tail is incomplete. That's because these are capable of autotomy. So this one most likely did self-amputate that last little bit of its tail at some point. Fully complete tails in this species are kind of rare, and they don't regenerate at all. And this is quite possibly the only inland snake species that eats fish in this region. But in addition to this, it does also eat frogs, frog eggs, and salamanders. We have a rather interesting looking spider down here in the dirt. This one. This is a spider in the genus Paratropis. These spiders, and perhaps others in the family Paratropidae, are commonly known as bald-legged spiders, but I'm not the biggest fan of this name, and I instead like to call them armored mud spiders. This one here is an adult. In fact, it's the first adult that I've seen. And I have seen a lot of juveniles of this genus around here. At least 10, I would say. So you can tell that they don't get very large. This is a non-tarantula mygalomorph. It doesn't create a trapdoor. It doesn't seem to lay any web. And it is very seldomly seen in burrows. You can encounter these most frequently by seeing them walking around at night or by digging in topsoil. They like to live between the surface roots, above the clay, but below the leaf litter. So why does this spider look so dirty? Well, it's actually on purpose. These have something called a scaly cuticle, or otherwise, the outer layer of its exoskeleton is textured differently, and in such a way that the mud that they come into contact with sticks to their exoskeleton, and it doesn't come off very easily after this. While this might be for camouflage purposes, it isn't entirely known what caused this adaptation. We have a Caecilian moving through this leaf litter right here. This is Gunther's Caecilian. Caecilia guntheri, and I believe it is only found in Colombia and Ecuador. It lives in moderate elevation forests in the Andes, as well as other forests that are adjacent to that zone. And if I recall correctly, these do have a lower elevation limit, but here I am quite close to sea level. In fact, you might be able to hear the ocean in the background, so I'm not sure what to make of this identification. I don't know the species too well at all. This is one of several species of Caecilians that are in the Choco rainforest of Colombia and Ecuador, described and undescribed. Supposedly, the ones in Colombia vary more than the ones in Ecuador and tend to be shorter. In addition to this, this is one of the largest terrestrial Caecilians that lives in the Neotropics, and possibly even the world, as some have been observed reaching over a meter in length. This species is predominantly nocturnal, although you can see them during the day on some occasions, and they're really quite common during heavy rains. I think I've seen over 20 by now. I have even seen them eating worms on a few occasions, one of which is this really pink and kind of rough feeling worm that lives around here. Which was not a very pretty sight at all. Look what we have down here on this plant. What might at first not look like the tarantula that we are looking for is actually the juvenile of Xenesthis, believe it or not, and it really is not all that large.
As we just saw, the juveniles of Xenesthis are arboreal, though I'm sure it is possible to come across them on the ground on some occasions.
This one is likely 1 to 2 molts away from being terrestrial. It's also quite close to undergoing a major color shift. I'm sure the first thing that you noticed about this one is how different it looks from the adult. There are other tarantulas that look like this when they're juveniles and undergo the same change, such as Pamphobeteus species, and this is a relationship that I'll revisit later. At this size, these are pretty much only eating insects, the ones that they find living in the same plants as them. And also at this size, they seem to have a different walking pattern than the adults, which I find to be quite interesting. There we go. We are on the side of a stream right now, this one, and on the embankment, there is a tarantula burrow, this one right here. This one belongs to Xenesthis, the tarantulas that we're looking for tonight, but it's been abandoned despite the fact that there are some parts in here. Several weeks of looking into this hole every night, and I haven't seen anything. In addition to that, I have a slight suspicion that that is not a molt, but perhaps the remains of a tarantula. I can't be too sure though. Look at this snake down here. We have a glasstail. This one is Urotheca fulviceps. And glasstail does mean that it can autotomize or lose its tail, so I do have to be careful here. Here it is. This snake that we have here is commonly referred to as the red-headed glasstail. Glasstail is one of the names that refers to the entire genus, but they're also referred to as litter snakes and brittle snakes. Glasstail and brittle snake are both referring to the same thing here. Their tail breaks off quite easily, and that's actually the reason why this one is incomplete. It's probably only missing a couple centimeters at most, but if it were to be pinned in the right spot, this tail could break off quite close to the cloaca. This one that we have here is an adult snake. It still has coloration on its head that's quite different from the rest of its body, which is what gives it its common name, the red-headed glasstail snake, but the head coloration on juveniles is much brighter than this. This is a snake that is either diurnal or nocturnal, somewhat depending on the weather, and it's completely terrestrial, searching mainly through leaf litter to find little lizards. And though it is not commonly seen, it does have a substantial distribution. These are found in Costa Rica, Panama, Venezuela, Ecuador, and Colombia in a variety of different forests. Here on the ground we have a fairly small tarantula, and this one is presumably in the genus Neischnocolus. I think whatever we're looking at here is undescribed, and to be honest, I don't even know if this is in the genus Neischnocolus. I'm not the best at identifying tarantulas in the neotropics. Luckily, whatever species or genus this is, I have seen several at this point, so there are a few things that I can say about it. First thing that should be noted, this is not an adult. This one looks to be about 1/4 the size of a full-grown adult, which I believe I've only seen once at this point. The adult that I saw of this species was far more drab than the one that we're looking at right now. This species likes to hang out in leaf litter and rotting logs quite a bit, so when you scratch at the ground in those areas, sometimes these pop out, but I don't think I've seen one in its burrow yet. I'm just assuming that they create burrows. The described species of Neischnocolus from this area is Neischnocolus mckenna, and that species is far more common than this one. And there is another species of undescribed Neischnocolus out here, but for that one I'm almost certain on the genus, unlike the one that we have here. Down here on the ground is our second Xenesthis, and this one seems to be quite flighty, so it's certainly going to be a little bit difficult to catch. I'll show you. These Xenesthis tarantulas are distributed in Colombia and Venezuela, but I do think that there's a small chance that they range into Panama's Darien as well, and they are mostly found at moderate elevations, usually 1,000 meters or so. But relative to that, the ones that we're finding are quite low. We're about 200 meters above sea level right now. They're also almost completely restricted to rainforest habitats. Unsurprisingly, these are some of the largest tarantulas in all of South America, with only a couple genera being above them, and this allows them to be able to eat things like lizards, snakes, and frogs. They've even been recorded preying on the fertile ants. I said earlier that I would revisit Pamphobeteus' relationship with Xenesthis. These are actually sister genera, and both of them belong to the same clade as Theraphosa and Brachypelma species. Collectively, these represent the largest tarantulas in all of South America. In terms of size, as you get into Central America, this tarantula's niche is replaced by that of Sericopelma, which are also some fairly large tarantulas, ones that I've been able to observe in Panama. Well, that will be all for this video of looking for these tarantulas in the genus Xenesthis. Hope you enjoyed. Thank you for watching.